God's praise than when we first begun. As we gather this afternoon to pay our respects to an extraordinary lady and a very colorful and most definitely welcomed member of our community, we have some tributes. And those gentlemen doing the tributes, we have tributes coming from Rick Spanger, Mark Trail, Bob McCulloch, and Barry White. So if those gentlemen would like to come forward now, we can begin.
Thanks, Pastor Shepherd. Welcome to the family. Sorry we're meeting under these conditions, but I appreciate the 40 minutes. That's all. It's going to just about cover it. We're really good friends with the churches, and just the other day on Sunday, I walked down to the church lot and saw the destruction, the tree removal in the cabin, and I thought of all the memories that we had there, and coming down, you know, and these old cabins have to come down at some point, and the memories we made there will last forever. And, you know, I remember the old days when, you know, we all had old cabins. The kids would come running up to the house with sand up to their elbows, and they just ran in. Now we have these new places where we stand there with a hose and blow them off with a leaf blower and tell them not to go in. Don't touch anything. I mean, those days of old cabins and the comfiness is, you know, turning into something that, you know, doesn't have as much character as it used to. So, Christina and Earl had mentioned to Ann while I was walking through there that Ann had passed, and you know, a bunch of regret had filled me, because how many times did we say, oh, we got to phone churches, we got to get over there, and you know, there's that song, you know, the chase of the dream, because the dream won't chase you back. Well, it's pretty much a story for many of us, where we don't see the things we want to when we need to, and then it's too late. So anyway, enough of the sentimental stuff. We're going to get into some stuff, that personal stuff that the churches and Shar and I had together with our families. And, you know, a visit to the church cabin was always filled with anticipation and joy. Our kids learned to swim there, and we knew that as we approached the gate, if we touched that latch, the security system would set off. One click released a torrent of barking. White cotton, bald land piranha were coming straight at us with teeth, all nine of them, and only one of them friendly. It was running in the opposite direction because it was blind, and desperately trying to catch her before she ran into the lake. So, and a quick dash to the pool with a tiny herd of dogs out nipping at our nails. Get in the water, kids. We're safe there. To hell with pit bulls. We were dealing with the church choir. A nasty little crew. And our kids learned to swim there for hours. We had noodle fights. And if I was getting the best of my kids, beating them up with a noodle, Ann had this special larger noodle that she'd pull out, and it held water. When she swung it, I felt it. Leave the kids alone. The year was 2010. It was my 50th birthday, and we had people over. And I was just about to blow out the candles on my cake when someone said out of the blue, "Hey, did anybody see that lady in that Cadillac with all the pictures of her poodles in the window?" The room went deathly silent. He said, he continued to say, "I followed her, see where she went." "That was crazy," he said. Right, sitting right next to him was Ann. I said, "Joe, prepare to die." He was from Brazil. I played soccer with him. He happened to be the Padre at 15 wing. And Ann was going to send him back to Rio de Janeiro in a box. Willie Moser was there. His eyes were like saucers, mouth agape, and we were about to witness a human sacrifice in our living room. They locked eyes, Joe and Ann, and all of a sudden Ann cracked a smile and the room broke out in laughter. Everybody went home with the story of Ann. The campfires at the Wells, with the Wellses and Spangers and churches were common. Lots of laughs, moonlight cruises. One night we ran out of wood, saw a 3-foot chunk of railway tie that we thought we'd throw into the fire. And then around midnight we decided that this could burn all night, so we thought we'd toss it in the lake. It went under the water, came back up and whoomp, lit again. And off it floated down to Charlie Morkey's boat. Had to go in and get it and push it back to shore. And we smothered it out. We should have done that in the first place. But anyway, we wouldn't have been talking about it if we did. So, yeah, that was a lot of fun. And, of course, Anne always thought she was the best at water sports, and she was. One talented lady. She'd say, "Rick, you think you're good on that wakeboard? You got to try my bucking bronc." I didn't know what a bucking bronc was, but before I could say yes, I heard Bob light up that 8-cylinder motor in that boat, and off we went. Something that looked loosely like a horse with no head. I got on it and went for the ride of my life. I couldn't walk for 3 days. Splinters. 97% of them were taken up by the wetsuit, thank God. But anyways, and you know, it was just one of those things she had. She was quirky. She had all this silly stuff laying around and, you know, she would throw at you. And our kids loved Ann. Most of the time, they loved her. She'd say, "Dano, why is your dad cutting the lawn? Amber, why is your mom raking leaves? Candace says, I'm only 3, Ann. I don't care. What do you think your parents had kids for? Do something." And they listened to her. And at every wedding, Bob and Ann were invited. They had to be. There was no wedding without you guys. Might take 45 minutes.
It's getting close.
Okay. All right. In 2005, I'll speed this up, and I actually am speeding it up. Shar and I had bought an Amphicar out of Toronto, and we drove it down to the lake, Waccamaw Valley there. Ann didn't know who was driving, but she decided to follow this crazy car. And when she saw us getting out of it, she says, "Hey, can I get in there?" I said, "Ann, I don't know if it floats." She said, "I don't care. I can swim." Well, we barely made it back to shore because we were sinking fast. And she was laughing. We barely made it. And obviously the car was not advertised as it should have been. Might float. But she was so proud to be the first to ride in that car. She was our first passenger. And Ann was always there if we needed somebody. She'd say, "Well, what do you need done?" I said, "Well, I don't know." She says, "Okay, I'll go get Bob, you know." And over came Bob. If there was a hammer swinging, Bob was there. And Ann was right behind him. And we were usually the last ones to take the docks out. Somewhere early November. Ice was starting to gel on the lake. And I had bought these new floating docks, 96 feet of it. I think Bob Wells took a picture of that and said something about the lake and our big docks. And At the last one, I was trying to float it back and with a pole in the water, and Ann says, "Hey, what are you doing?" And I looked up and I dropped that stupid pole in the lake, and there I was floating away. And there I saw Ann running, you know, up the side of the cabin. I thought, "Oh, thank God, she's getting another pole or some rope or something." And she came back with a camera. "Hey, what are you gonna do now, Ricky?" So that was Ann in our life, you know. Always there, always a laugh, you know, and her accomplishments are so many. Our kids were so pleased when they came back from the Town and Country Mall that Mrs. Claus knew them by name. So Santa Claus could take a hike, you know, and just Mrs. Claus was it. Her devotion to, her duties at North Grove, you know, often referring to all of us residents as her people. You know, and taking her job very seriously. The light at the intersection of Daniel Drive and Highway 2, the Millennium Park was a big thing for her, and of course the Millennium Water Show. But the greatest of all her achievements was a daughter. Just a second. Sorry. Taken away, you know, at an early age. Get up here, Sharon. She was very proud of that. And we got to meet Debbie, and now we see the whole family. And just, it wore on her very hard. And it was, she knew there was a child out there. She asked us our ages, our birthdays, probably with everybody. "You got something on CHAB, you know," Ann says, "happy birthday, happy anniversary," you know, it was all Ann. But I could go on, and I'm sure you want to get home at some time. So, in ending, I respectfully say, I'm going to sound like a pastor. On the sixth day, God looked down and was happy with what he had made. On the seventh day, God said, "This will be a day of rest." December 29, 1941, along came Ann Peacock, and no one had rested since. And now, neither will God. Rest in peace, Ann. Thank you.
Hey, my name's Rob McCullough, and Ann's nephew. And I, too, have some memories of Buffalo Pound and the Bronco. I had some friends later who would take me on this tubing phenomenon, if anyone's heard of it, but it's nothing at all compared to the Bronco. And they'd just be like, "Wow, you're really good at this." I'm like, "This is nothing. This is easy. This doesn't hit you back." And I think I need to correct you, because you said you jumped in the pool there. But as I recall, there was no pee in it. It was just an ool. Yeah, as I recall. Anyhow, I've been asked to read a few words that Anne has asked to be read here, so I'll get straight to those. I should only be 42 minutes. God saw her getting tired. The cure was not to be. So he wrapped her in his loving arms and whispered, "Come with me." She suffered so much in silence. Her spirit did not bend. She faced her pain in silence. Her spirit did not bend. She faced her pain with courage until the very end. She tried so hard to stay with us. Her fight was all in vain. God took her to his loving home and freed her from all pain.
My turn. I got a voice like Bob, so you might have to shut these down. Nice to see everybody here. Well, as as everybody else so far has been saying, they've known Ann for a long time. I've known her for a long time because Bob has been my accountant forever and a very good friend, but I really got to know her in the last 3 months. So, when Ann moved to the Mulberry, Bob and I looked at the place and we said, oh boy, we maybe better help Bob and Ann get rid of some of their treasures here. So we decided to do that. And Barb and Ann would get together for a couple hours every afternoon from about 2 to 4. And they were going through all her treasures and stuff. And some was going to go to the Mulberry with her, and some was going to go into storage, and some was to be sold. But they had lots of fun, lots of laughter, I heard. So that was good. Meanwhile, my son Mike and I were setting up the grad sale. And when I say grad sale, you have no idea what I'm talking about. It was a grad sale. We had it for several days. We set it up. They had many, many good treasures. And you just couldn't believe the things that were there. Beautiful things, great stuff. And I knew there'd be a lot of people, but never dreamt that there'd be a lineup of cars out on Thatcher Drive and so on and so forth. That was just unbelievable. So it was really great. And I got to turn the page. I got to realize Ann was much more talented and outgoing than what we thought. We sold her flaming baton that she had when she was younger, and her white boots, and all these things. We seen the pictures like you wouldn't believe as going along there. And the crafts, who would have known, unless you really got to know her, like those Easter eggs were professional, eh? Unbelievable, beautiful stuff. Ann told Barb that she worked at the family grocery store in Davidson. When her dad passed, she continued helping her mom in the store. And when it came time to sell it, she could hardly wait because she was waiting to marry Bob. Now, she should have talked to me first. And when you look at the picture out there, I guess maybe when they were together, he was quite a hunk back then, eh? She got to travel all over the place, and when we were doing the yard sale for her, you wouldn't believe it, downstairs, she didn't drink, but she had, I don't know how big the wall was, at least 10 feet, with shelving built, especially for these little bottles that you get in the airplane, from every trip she went on. There are, I don't know, 300, 400, 500 of them all together. And the young couple, two young fellas that bought these, they were freshly over here from a different country, immigrants, like, okay? And they were having a ball with that. They couldn't believe all this stuff was going on. So it was really good to see. Then on the other wall, she had little bottles of sand and little from every place she'd stopped, or almost every place, and rocks. Things just a reminder of all the stuff she'd done. I think she worked so hard in the store that when she got flying around, she thought she'd better keep some souvenirs, just like she kept Bob. Ann's car, no, usually a Cadillac, and I tried to get her to a Chrysler, but anyways, usually a Cadillac, and it was always easy to spot. Because it usually had a Rough Rider flag or a warrior flag, and usually poodle dogs in the back, not real ones, but stuffed ones, you could always spot it. She was Well, when I got the car from her, it was an antenna on the side that had two flags on it. Oh, she also had a horn in there that you could make the sound of a dog, you could make a police siren, you could boot pretty near anything. But actually a loudspeaker too, so she could likely tell you off if she had to. Now, Anna and I never had any words except for one little bit. She when she'd phone, she had asked to speak to the better half. I tried to explain to her I was the better half. Didn't go for that. Okay, I got to see where I'm at here because I get carried away. Oh, yeah, it was obvious she loved holidays and celebrated them all. She had a Santa Claus or Mrs. Claus outfit. She had an Easter Bunny outfit. She had all these things. And her yard and house was decorated to the top. So I think she won a couple of prizes even with it, you know. And if she didn't, she should have. I knew she loved dogs. And I got to know her dogs, Missy and Caleb. I also became a friend of theirs. I tried to get in ahead of Bob there a bit. I found out where the treats were. And if you want to get in with the dogs, you find that you give them the treats. Bob would say, now don't give them too many. No, Bob, I'm busting them in half. Wrong. But anyways, I also found out, just from doing this sale with her, we really got to know her quite well. When she got the dogs clipped, she saved the fur. She had them give them the fur. She had put that in the trees so the birds could build their nests with it. And it was really pretty neat. And so she just loved the birds and the squirrels. She loved animals all the way around. I'm getting ahead of myself. The next line I already told you. When Ann would meet with Barb, she'd walk by the trailer that we had outside, hooked onto my truck, stuff that might be going to the East End Mall, the garbage dump. And she would check it out to make sure that I wasn't throwing anything out that she might want to keep or somebody else should have. And it was quite amusing. She never took anything back. Bob did haul a few things into storage, I suppose. And anyways, it was quite neat. I also learned they had many, and I heard this earlier too, many years of enjoyment out at the lake. The one thing I hadn't heard yet today was something that Bob told me. I think for many years, he figured 15 years or more, they'd get up in the morning, pour a glass of wine, get on the water skis, and go across the lake without spilling the wine. Now, Ann didn't drink, so it didn't matter if she spilled a bit. Bob, on the other hand, he didn't spill a drop. So anyways, that was quite neat. Barb, my wife, said to Ann, when they were doing this, going through everything every day, well, almost every day, eh, Bob, for a couple hours in the afternoon, she said to Ann, so selling so many of your treasures, does it bother you? And Ann said, not really, because it's time. No, I'm doing it. So in closing, I felt that we got quite close to Ann. Oh, I got to change my voice. That's no good. Tell me to smarten up, Bob. Anyways, I thought we got quite close to Ann and found out what a great person she really was. And my boy, my son Michael and his wife got very close to her. Whew. Excuse me, folks. This is not like me. Anyways, got very fond of her.
and quite lucky to have known her. So in closing, I've got to say, we remember Ann as a fun person, great community lady, and she will always be remembered.
I don't know how you do it.
Hello, all. We went for breakfast this morning with Bob today, and we reminisced about a bunch of things with some laughs, some hugs. So thank you for that, Bob. Bob is really appreciative for those of us who traveled far and come locally to honor Ann. I'm Mark Trail, Bob and Ann's son-in-law. I read the write-up on Musha Funeral website on Ann. Wow, what a busy lady she was. Thank you to the funeral staff for looking after Ann and Bob. It's much appreciated. Ann was the type of lady who knew what she wanted. She was determined in what she wanted and didn't take no for an answer. I think her German background had something to do with it. Anne did many things during her life, as you can see from the obituary, of which of them, one of them was five-pin bowling. Now, five-pin bowling, who would have thought that that would take Anne to her next journey in life? Well, I ran 2 five-pin bowling leagues. That's how I met Debbie. About 26 years ago at an IBM five-pin bowling league banquet, a gal came over showing pictures of her brothers and sisters that she just found because she was adopted. And she knew that Debbie was adopted. So I grabbed Debbie and I said, "You're not going to believe this, but come and see." I said to Debbie, "If you have any thoughts to finding your birth mother, you may want to start looking now, because you never know how long it'll take, or if it would even happen." When Debbie's adopted mother passed away, her adopted father gave Debbie her adopted papers. And so Debbie knew Ann's name was Peacock, and she was adopted through Children's Aid. Needless to say, they found each other in less than a year because both of them were looking for one another. They both signed up at Parent Finders, who weren't as rigid as the Children's Aid was. When they finally connected, Ann told us how supportive Bob was for her to find her daughter. So Anne's new journey began 16, 17, 18, 20-page letters going back and forth to one another. It was amazing to sit back and see some interesting facts that stood out. Anne's birthday was December 29th, was the same date that Debbie and I got married. Our first name, our first child, we named her Shannon, Amanda Trail, cat for short. Shannon spelt with a C. And one of Ann's poodles was named Shannon, spelt with a C. Ann named her daughter Deborah, and so did her adopted parents without knowing that information. We visited Moose Jaw when the kids were 6 and 3 years old and had a great time having a birthday party for both her grandchildren. Inviting neighbors' kids at the lake, making cupcakes. and she positioned the cupcakes like caterpillars, like a caterpillar. Gifts were exchanged every year, and Anne would send gifts she made or saw on TV, and would send us what I'll call gadgets, and we had to guess what they were. So we had to give several guesses before she would tell us. And out of all of them, we did guess a few of them. Debbie remembers Anne at the cottage and her pink boat. There's something about time and distance being a factor, but they always talked and exchanged gifts to the end. For Mother's Day this year, Debbie's gift she sent was misplaced due to the moving to Mulberry Place with one bedroom and two bedroom situation that they were trying to get figured out, at the same time trying to move out of their other house. Needless to say, it was in one of those mailboxes, and when Anne opened it, she called right away saying she loved the necklace that said Mom and had a paw print on it. Debbie's thoughts was it was double duty. She was a mom to Debbie, and she was a mom to the dogs. Last thing I'll share with you, and I'll always remember, I got to take a quick look around for a second. I always remember Anne, Mrs. Claus, sent us a stencil of a big footprint and sparkling reindeer stuff in a bag, reindeer food, with instructions saying to use baking powder making footprints from the fireplace to the tree. I started out heavy, then fainter as I got closer to the tree. Christmas morning, our kids, Shannon and Tyler, got up. They go down to the tree, and both coming running, shouting, "Mommy, Daddy, Santa Claus has been here. We can see his footprints." So thank you, Anne, for that. You will be pleased to know I've shared this many times with others. Rest in peace now, Anne.
Well, what can you say after that other than,
wow,
absolutely wonderful, brilliant tributes. Thank you so much. I'm sure that Anne and her new home is listening to all those words and having a nice smile over the nice things you've said. As we begin and continue our service this afternoon, let's bow our heads in prayer for just a moment. God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our sister Anne. We thank you, Lord, for giving her to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us your aid so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. This we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Well, it's not too tough to guess that this young lady had a full life and a full life well lived. From her profound involvement in any community where she lived, we know that up in Davidson, she was involved in figure skating and curling and you name it, she was in it. She was involved. Taught Sunday school up in Davidson as well. Mrs. Santa Claus, for heaven's sake. And I met her. I met Mrs. Santa Claus. And I thought, oh, Santa, big deal. But Mrs. Claus, wow, that was just great. She won the most decorated house awards in town a couple of years. She should have won, as somebody mentioned, the most decorated car in the entire universe every year. Quite the lady, a real individual who was not by any means afraid of sharing herself with others. Over the years, her health had its few ups and downs, but in 2003, she was bitten by the cancer bug. A year-long fight with that, and then it was in remission, and it was back, and it went back and forth. But she came out of that after a year even stronger than when she went into that fight. The last few years, though, were definitely not kind to Anne. Diabetes and related heart problems, related mobility problems, all added up. They all added up. They caught up with her, and she left us just last Friday. A bittersweet day is a day like this, a day when we grieve the loss, but at the same time we celebrate the life. And we ask ourselves, what happens to us when this life is over? We're born, we live, we die, that's it? Well, that's not it. We turn to the Gospel of St. John, and to put this in context, it was the day in the church we call Maundy Thursday. It was the day of the Last Supper. Jesus and his mates were all gathered in that upper room, and they were having the Last Supper. He knew what was ahead for him, and he knew it wasn't good. Everybody seemed to be on edge that time. And he said, listen, boys, don't worry. Things are fair grim right now, but they're going to get better. I promise you that. That leads us to our reading, just a wee short reading from the Gospel of St. John. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. So that where I am, you may be also. So that's the answer to the big question. When our few short years on this in this plane of existence are over, we go to a grand and glorious reunion with all who have gone before. Good news for a day like today. Good news for a day like today. And those who, like Anne, knew that along life's journey, they were never, never alone. Through the peaks and through the valleys of life, God was right there with them. And one of the absolutely towering figures in the Bible who was eminently aware of that was the mighty King David. Now, King David was a mighty warrior. He joined and united the kingdoms of Judah and Israel to the veritable superpower of his day. No military power could compete with King David. If you read the book of Solomon, a couple of books of Solomon, a few chapters in there, you'll find that he was a bit of a scoundrel as well. He did things that he ended up in jail for today. Although from what we're seeing from the States, never mind. But he was a bit of a scoundrel, quite a bit of a scoundrel. But at the same time, he always walked with God. He wore his faith on his sleeve. And he was a mighty man of God and a mighty warrior as well. The humble man of God is credited with leaving us these words. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul and guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. I will live in the house of the Lord forever, not just as summer holidays, not a couple of weeks here and there, but forever, through all eternity, we will live in the house of the Lord. More good news for a day like today. Well, it's a good news day, and it's a sad day too, no question of that. And we grieve the passing of Anne because she's gone, and she's gone from our sight. Maybe you noticed last week the snowbirds were zooming over the city. They did that a couple of times, said, hey, look at us, here we are. And as I saw them last week from the back deck, big pot of tea over here in my book, and there are the snowbirds, I thought of a story that was told at my mom's funeral years ago. We look at a plane and see it streaking across the sky, and we look and we say, well, there she goes, gone from our sight. But on the other side, they look up and they say, hey, look at this, here she comes, here she comes. And that's just what we're experiencing right now. Anne is definitely gone from our sight, but she's gone to the other side that's been promised to us through our good and gracious God. And right now, if they haven't already said it, they're saying, look, here she comes. Everybody smarten up, because here comes Anne. And that's good news for a day like today. Amen. Now we have one congregational hymn, and everyone is invited to sing out in voices three times our size, because I'm down to about 75% voice right now. Church in the Wildwood, the lyrics will be up on the screen in just half a moment, so please sing with great gusto. We'll sing this one for Anne. There's a church in the valley by the wildwood, no lovelier spot in the dale. No place is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale. Oh, come, 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 come. Come to the church in the wildwood. Oh, come to the church in the vale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale. How sweet on a clear Sabbath morning to list to the clear ringing bell. Its tones so sweetly are calling, oh, come to the church in the vale. Oh, come, 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 come to the church in the wildwood. Oh, come to the church in the vale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale. From the church in the valley by the wildwood, when day fades away into night, I would fain from this spot of my childhood wing my way to the mansions of light. Oh, come, 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 come to the church in the wildwood. Oh, come to the church in the vale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as that little brown church in the vale. Well done. You got the job. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks, Lord, because by his death, Jesus destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present, nor things to come, shall be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in the kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Anne. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all your saints in light. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.